So, hands up any of you that have painted a room, taken a step backwards and gone yuck. Today we're talking about one of the most fundamental, one of the most basic, but also one of the easiest ways of transforming any room, even one like that. We're talking about colour. And in this programme, I want you to get to grips with it. I want you to understand it. And I want you to think beyond Magnolia. Because there's more to colour than meets the eye. Wonderful yet complicated thing about colour is that it affects every aspect of our lives, even our bodies. Because you can be feeling a little off colour. You can be in the pink. You can be having a black mood. You can be seeing red. And of course you can go as white as a sheet. The reason colours are so important to us is that our visual senses are so highly developed. Each of our eyes contains around 37 million light-sensitive receptors. The white light we see is made up of different wavelengths, and each wavelength is a different colour, from violet, the shortest wavelength, to red, which is the longest. Each of these colours is received and recognised in a different pathway of the brain. But more of that a bit later. At a basic level, the colours in light affect our hormones, our health, our mood. Even science describes colour as sensation. Hence the fact that specific colours have a big impact, and our take on colour is highly personal. You have your preferences, I certainly have mine. And the decision as to which colours we love and which colours we loathe will almost certainly be made before we reach puberty.
Orange and yellow and purple and green. Orange and purple and blue.
I don't like brown because it's dull.
I don't like yellow because it's too bright.
I don't like blue because it's cold.
I don't like red because it's the colour of blood.
I don't like green because it reminds me of grass.
I like all colours, apart from magnolia.
Sing a rainbow too.
Colour preferences seem to start very early in life. In fact, most studies show that children like red, orange and yellow up to the age of five. And either at the age of five, which coincides with their change of teeth, or at a later stage, at the age of 13 or 14, they seem to start preferring the sort of blues and greens.
Interesting. So long before we've picked up one of these, it seems we've already decided what colours we like and what colours we don't. But however strong that compulsion to paint every room in the house your own favourite but rather scary shade of golden primrose, imagine here, golden primrose. Remember, there are things you need to consider first. So let's get practical and get out to our guinea pig project house, where we can demonstrate some of the issues you should think about when choosing colours for your home. And there's a scary amount to think about here, I can tell you.
In a white room with black curtains near the station.
Welcome to a typical Victorian dining room that's fallen on decorative hard times. Okay, if you don't own one, then phone a friend who does. Because what this room needs more than anything is colour. Okay, as I said earlier, colour is a purely personal choice. And before you start shouting purple at me, I will point out that yes, I am a purple fan, but no, I've only ever used it four times on television. What this room needs more than anything is a bit of colour loving. It needs a wrap-round, warm, cuddly colour palette to really bring it to life.
Oh,
This room is just such a missed opportunity. It's a bit like seeing a beautiful supermodel with the most fantastic bone structure who's had her makeup done by Damien Hirst. It's just all over the place and completely and utterly doesn't work. In fact, the colour scheme in here is like drowning in muesli, and I'm oatmealophobic. But even muesli's got sultanas in it, so at least there's something a bit fruity. I want to take this room and I want to shake it and I want to make it over and I want to make it beautiful. I want to make it fulfill its true potential. Stop right there. This program is about getting back to basics, so let's get basic. Number one, get to know your room. Now, the biggest effect on colour and the biggest effect on your room comes from light and sunlight in particular. We only actually understand colour from the amount of light that it absorbs or bounces back. In fact, if I painted this room one colour and I painted the kitchen next door the identical colour, they would look completely different. Colour changes depending on whether you face north, south, east or west. In fact, it even changes throughout the day. At dawn, it'll be pink. Midday, it'll be blue. Evening, it's going to be purpley red. If you don't believe me, watch this. This mimics evening light. Let's see the effect. And this light simulates daylight. See what I mean? This room is northwest, which means that the sun sets over there. It will have a tendency to be cold and rather chilly seeming. So it needs lovely wraparound warm colours, and it also faces onto this grass. Green, isn't it? And that's going to affect the colour of the light in the room, which is something that people often forget. But it's well worth thinking about. If we painted this room a sunny yellow, the light bouncing back from the grass could give it an acid tinge, not what we're after at all. And now that we've come over all practical, one other thing to keep in mind is the type of paint you use can be radically affected by light. Gloss reflects, matte absorbs, see what I mean? Anyway, back to light. Light has a major effect on colour, and if you're looking for rules, the way your room faces is a big consideration. East and north-facing rooms get less sunlight, so they tend to be darker and colder. South and west-facing rooms get more sunlight. Geography, where you live, also plays a part. Calming blues might look great in Cornwall, but we'll end up looking depressingly dull in Aberdeen. So, as a rule of thumb, find out where the light in your room comes from and where it goes. Most people find that north or east-facing rooms with their chilly aspect need bright, warm colour palettes. Whereas south or west-facing rooms are warm enough in their own right to take cooler colours. Okay, so you've found the direction from which the light's coming from. Surely it's time to reach for the colour chart. No! Stop! There's another design rule you need to think of. What is the use of the space? What is the identity of the space? Is it for relaxing? Is it for sleeping? Is it for the family to get together? All of these functions have a bearing on the appropriate colour to use. Now, this isn't hard and fast because, let's face it, we've all got our favourite colours, but as a general rule, certain rooms and activities suit certain colours. Busy family kitchens work best with cool, relaxing colours. Trendy singles can take more drama. And bright colours don't always work in bathrooms, not if you want to soak in a calming bubble bath, and let's face it, who doesn't? As for bedrooms, want a good night's sleep? Think before slapping on manic yellow, orange, or red. Strong colours are sometimes best confined to rooms that get less use, such as hallways, or where you want a more intimate feel, like our project dining room. This room is an evening room, and it can take colours that come forward to meet you and give you a bit of a cuddle. In fact, I think most of us notice that strong colours like yellows and reds actually have a physical impact on the way that we feel about a space. If you want proof, We've scientifically recreated well-documented research putting people in identical rooms painted or lit in red and blue. And the effects are interesting. People in the blue room consistently turned the heating up 2 degrees, even though both rooms were the same temperature.
I felt like when I went into the red, I felt really warm, really comfortable. And the blue just made me feel quite cold and I wanted to get out of it and felt quite uneasy, actually.
In the red rooms, brainwave activity of people increased, as did arrhythmia, heightened variation in heartbeat, and even sweating. Blue, in contrast, led to higher alpha and delta waves, brainwaves associated with relaxation. It's called chromodynamics. Wow.
Yeah, I preferred blue. It was a lot calmer, almost sort of quite serene. Felt quite relaxed with that, compared to the red, which was very hard on the eyes. And very quite intense.
We do know that some colors are more arousing than others. For example, red and yellow appear to be more arousing than blue and green. In other words, we tend to be more excited if we are exposed to long wavelengths, which is the reds and yellows, as opposed to short wavelengths, which is the blues and greens.
It does sound very scientific, but it's common sense. In a bedroom where you want to relax, you don't necessarily want strong, vibrant colours like reds or yellows. And by the same token, here in a kitchen, strong colours like that will make you heat up. Think of the kind of colours they use in restaurants. As a rule, fast food restaurants use colder light over the tables, shiny hard surfaces, and a repeated use of bright primary colours like orange, yellow, and red, as our cameras show. Although these colours are initially inviting and actually make us feel hungry, that's not all they do.
These colours do attract people to come into their space to have their fast food they want to eat, but it also may be have another effect. It may sort of speed up the eating habits of people so that they actually leave the spaces faster than they would have done otherwise.
So, now we know colour can make us feel hot and cold, it can arouse our brains and chill us out. Surely it's time to go shopping. Years ago, when paints were made from ground-up natural pigments like these, there was a pretty limited choice. They call me mellow yellow. I mean, the ancient Britons had woad and not much else, whilst the Romans stuck to red, white and gold. They call me mellow yellow. Today, colour is a multi-squalty, squillion-pound industry. We get through 186 million litres of paint a year, probably enough to paint the surface of the moon, if you could be bothered. But although there are more than 2,000 colours to choose from, we're not exactly a nation of risk-takers when it comes to choice. They call me mellow yellow.
Despite the phenomenal quantities involved, we're still depressingly conservative about what ends up on the wall. Although, we can let our hair down a little bit as far as tester pots go. Chocolate chip cookie, anybody? Or what about a bit of baboon bum blue? Or maybe some yam yellow? In fact, if you want to know the nation's top 10 favourite paint colours, watch on. Wonder what's going to be number one.
At number 10, it's natural Hessian, a kind of cream. And at number 9, it's Arena, which is another kind of cream. At number 8, it's Ivory. Guess what? It's another kind of cream. At number 7, it's natural terracotta, which makes a change. At number 6, it's Egyptian cotton, cream again. Coming in at number 5, it's Honey Gold, our first yellow. Welcome. At number 4, it's Lazy Lilac. Nice. And at number 3, it's Happy Violet. Wow, brightest colour yet, comparatively. And number 2, it's Sunbeam, the second yellow to light up those grey days. And topping the chart are the nation's fave at number 1, unbelievably, it's Magnolia. another kind of cream.
So I see absolutely no reason why you lot shouldn't be a bit more courageous about colour. I know you want to, but I know you're scared. Now, there are three things that can help. Very straightforward. Number one, when you make the decision on which colour you want to try out, don't do that thing of taking the tin home, taking the lid off, looking at it and being sick. What you see in the tin is not what you're going to get on the wall, okay? Number two, rather than doing little tiny dibs and dabs of colour all over the wall, go for a big block so you can really see what it looks like. I actually like to do it in a corner so that you're going to see it in light and in shade. And then number three, with your tester patch, make sure that you give it at least two coats so that whatever's on the wall is not going to come through and affect the way that the colour looks. Be brave. You know you want to.
You see, all you need is a bit of silky encouragement and some confidence. So here goes. Here's the room. We know which way it faces, where the light comes from, and what it's used for. The choice for this room is warm. I want to make the room feel intimate. Now, I could go for some strong, bold, contrasting colours, but what do I mean by contrasting? To help, this is a colour wheel. The wheel is made up of contrasting or opposite colours. Red and yellow on the warm side, blue and green on the cool side. Red and green are opposites or contrasts. Blue and yellow also are opposites, but they're all linked in the brain. Proof? I am going to fill the screen with red and I want you to really, really focus on the red, okay? You ready? Go. Now look, 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 look hard and then close your eyes. Now, unless you're colourblind, at the moment, your little retina should be awash with green. Okay, you can look again. That is because colours share similar pathways into the brain. And the same kind of thing happens if you focus on yellow. You then get an aftersight of blue. This whole red-green brain pathway thingy isn't just an interesting Trivial Pursuit question, but it has implications for us hunter-gatherers.
The genes for the red and green sensitive photopigments are on the X chromosome. Men only have one X chromosome and women have two X chromosomes. So if there is a gene change on one X chromosome, then a man is colour deficient. And 8% of men have some sort of red-green colour deficiency. For a woman to be colour deficient, she has to have an abnormality of the same gene on both of her X chromosomes. So the prevalence in women is slightly less than 0.5%, 1 in 200 or 1 in 250.
Calling all blokes, is that why women get to choose the paint colours then, on the grounds that we're rubbish at it? Shame.
Okay, so red is the opposite of green, blue is the opposite of yellow, and orange is the opposite of purple. But what happens when you stick them in a room together? Imagine a yellow room with a blue sofa. Do opposites attract? No. What happens is the blue becomes much more intense because it's next to the yellow. The yellow becomes so much more intense because it's next to the blue. That's great if you're going for vibrancy, but if you're going for peace, forget it. I mean, look at this. How orange does that look? And it looks that orange because you're seeing it behind a purple wall.
So, if contrast isn't your thing, let's go for harmony. Time to talk colour families and back to the colour wheel. Colours that live next to each other on the colour wheel are called families. They share similar characteristics, take yellow and blue. Mix them together and you have green. So azure, turquoise, sky, aqua, emerald, lime, olive and lemon are all in the same family. The same would be true of yellow, orange and red, or red, purple and blue. Each colour also has tone. Now stick with me here.
It's not magic, it's quite straightforward. See colour in black and white. Look at the tonality, i.e. the darkness or the lightness. If you're trying to put different colours from the same family together, provided they are as dark as each other or as light as each other, they will unfailingly work.
And what happens when you simplify things even further? And you just get tonal.
Instead of the complications of decorating with different contrasting colours, why not just pick one colour?
Tonal decorating, using different shades of the same colour, say reds, pinks, or as here, beiges, might mean that you end up with a bit of a sludgy soup with very, very little definition to it. So texture becomes terribly important, or otherwise, how will you tell what's a sofa and what's a coffee table? Right, you lot, we've looked at how light affects colour, how we react to colour, contrasting colours and colour families. Blimey, we've done so much. But it's also worth thinking about how colour can affect architecture.
Golden brown, texture like sun, lays me down with my mind she runs.
The use of colour can actually help with the proportions of a room. This room has beautiful proportions, lovely high ceiling, but if it was more squat, what I'd do would be to take the wall colour up onto the cornice or the coving, literally steal a couple of inches from the ceiling, which will make the wall feel taller. In this instance, I'm actually going to paint the ceiling and the cornice the same colour, and then the wall from there down. Extravagant, but worth it.
Obviously, when I say I'm going to paint it, I mean he is. Anyway, what I'm doing is using colour to affect the architectural space. Here it will bring the ceiling down, part of my plot to make the evening room feel cosier. But there are other techniques, or optical illusions. If you're in the extraordinarily lucky position of having a room too large, like this one, you can use strong, bold colours that advance, appearing to bring the ceiling and the walls inwards.
And then there's colour blocking. Drawing attention to an architectural feature with a strong or different colour and a neutral border. Now, that sounds hugely designery, but when you think about it, most of you are doing that at home already. Look at this rug. It's eye-catching, it's a vibrant colour, forcing your eye into the middle of the floor. The neutral flooring around it blurs, it disappears, making the room feel bigger. So what happens if you apply this kind of principle to a wall?
Well, it's the same as the rug, really. Blocks of strong colour advance, allowing the neutral colours around to recede, stretching the room away into the distance. Using receding colours like green and blue has a history. NASA used grey-blue in Skylab to make it feel more spacious. And the last governor of Alcatraz, that great design guru, painted the cells pale green as a way of relaxing his, guests. Which brings us neatly to how colour can affect mood.
Now, you see, what I mean by that is that colour not only affects a room, it affects the way that you feel when you go into the room. Probably something to do with brain waves and wavelengths. But what I'm saying is that colour and mood are linked.
There's something in crimson. Something that should be stopped.
Red is vibrant and passionate, the colour of blood, war and fire. It's assertive, bold and risky.
Warm.
Pink, romantic, but can be shocking. Orange is joyful and exciting and stimulates the appetite. Yellow, sunny and happy, but can be egotistical and argumentative. Green, natural, harmonious and balanced. And blue, calming, sleep-inducing, the favourite colour of the majority of people, on which note.
Colour, like fashion, has fads, often related to the way we feel about ourselves or the way we feel society is going.
Yeah. Olive is definitely in. Everything that can possibly mean anything, anywhere, at least for a year, has got to be olive.
The word zeitgeist is very important. This means that colours and fashions and trends very much reflect the spirit of our time. For example, in the early 70s, we had the three-day week, we had the winter of discontent, and the whole of our market switched over to very natural colours. In 1979, Maggie Thatcher came into power, and there was immediately a spirit of optimism, and we had colours like bright jewel colours in our palettes, and deep, rich colours that were very powerful. And then we had the 1987 crash, and again we went back to naturals, but much warmer naturals this time. They're much more what we call cocooning type of naturals. Halfway through the 90s, we came out of the recession, and we've seen a huge influx of pinks, reds and oranges. And this represents a lot of energy, a lot of dynamism and a lot of positive thinking as a nation. Since 9/11, the American colour palettes have gone quite subdued. Blues and greens and aquas, these colours are much cooler. They're peace-loving. Blue is a peace-loving colour. And I think, given the circumstances we're in at the moment, it's not a surprise that the palettes are going towards the blue-green end of the spectrum.
Anyway, let's get back to our evening dining room, the one, if you remember, we were going to wrap in warm and cuddly colours. I love it when a plan comes together. So, having got rid of all those boring shades of bogey, look at this. A gorgeous, fruity, warm evening space, which is specifically calculated to rebalance the green light that gets bounced into the room from the grass. And it also goes to show that as long as you stick within your colour family, there's no end to it. I mean, I could go on and on and on. More aubergine, pomegranate, ruby, amethyst, all of the shades from the warm half of the colour palette. The same thing would be true if I was going on the cool side, so blues, greens, teals, aquas. There are accent colours in here, but they're natural accent colours. There's the bitter chocolate of the wood and this kind of doughy linen colour. But just because I can, and just because I felt like showing off, come look at this. The perfect vase. That's what I call intense accenting. So, which colour best suits your personality? Are you a warm or a cool colour person? Take the colour challenge on our website, www.bbc.co.uk/homes. In our next programme, Let There Be Light, well, I suppose someone had to say it, a look at the influence of light on our rooms and how we can use it to our best advantage.
And that's at the same time, 7:30 next Monday here on BBC Two.